Look at all that water. Just think about the energy that is stored in there, ready to do work. That form of energy is called gravitational potential energy, stored energy that gravity can turn into kinetic energy. When it does become kinetic energy, it can be converted into hydroelectric power that can heat homes, restaurants, and stores, and run computers. But gravity isn't the only force that can have potential energy. In this segment, we're going to talk about electric potential energy. That's energy stored by electric charges. When we know the amount of electric potential energy we can store, we also know the amount of electrical energy we can generate. When electrical engineers design the circuits that provide electrical power, they need to know how much electric potential energy they have to work with. And that's essential for running everything from electric toothbrushes to lights in football stadiums. Let's dig a little deeper into electric potential energy. We know that it's the magnitude of the work performed on a charged object by an electric field. In other words, electric potential energy is the energy that a charge in an electric field possesses, which gives it the ability to do work. Like all forms of energy, electric potential energy is a scalar quantity. But unlike other scalar quantities like speed and temperature, it can be positive or negative. Now, it has nothing to do with direction like it would in a vector quantity, but is determined by whether energy is lost or gained in a system. Electric potential energy depends on three things: the type of charge, whether it's positive or negative, the amount of charge, and the strength of the electric field it's in. Electric potential energy uses the same units as gravitational potential energy, joules. We can figure out how much energy a system has by considering the electric charges and fields that are involved. Let's do a quick calculation to see how that works. Say you have a charge of positive 5 times 10 to the negative 12 coulombs, creating an electric field. If a second point charge of negative 3 times 10 to the negative 15 coulombs is 7 meters away, what is the electric potential energy stored by the second charge? Electric potential energy equals the constant K times the product of the charges divided by the distance between them. Now we plug in what we know. K is 9 times 10 to the 9th newton meter squared per coulomb squared. This is multiplied by the first charge, positive 5 times 10 to the negative 12 coulombs, times the second charge, which is negative 3 times 10 to the negative 15th coulombs, divided by a distance of 7 meters. Plugging these values into the electric potential energy equation gives us negative 1.9 times 10 to the negative 17 newton meters. Since a newton meter equals 1 joule, our answer is that the electric potential energy of the second point charge equals negative 1.9 times 10 to the negative 17 joules. Notice that the sign of each charge matters, and the answer is a negative number. The negative sign tells us that work must be done on the system to keep these charges apart. So electric potential energy is the ability of a charge to do work. But how does that, work? Let's say we have two charged plates. The top plate is positively charged, and the bottom plate is negatively charged. You can see the electric field lines going from the positive plate to the negative plate. Let's put a positive charge in the electric field. Work must be done to push a positive charge towards the positive plate, or away from the negative plate. When the positive charge is moving opposite the direction of the electric field, we call that moving up the field. The further up the field the positive charge goes, the more work you have to do, like if you were pushing a ball uphill. When the positive charge is here near the positive plate, what kind of electric potential energy does it possess? If you said it's high or strong, that's right. In fact, we can say that the charge has maximum electric potential energy. The charge doesn't want to be up here. So if you let it start to move, it will be repelled away from the positive plate and attracted towards the negative plate. It will accelerate all the way down. While it's falling, what's happening? Think back to gravitational potential energy of the dam, because this works in a very similar way. If your answer was that the electric potential energy is decreasing, being converted into kinetic energy, you're right. When it reaches the negative plate at maximum velocity, how much electric potential energy is left? If you said none, you got it right again. It has no electric potential energy left. It all changed to kinetic energy. Another important characteristic of electric potential energy is that it is conservative, which means that it obeys the law of conservation of energy. Whatever an object loses in potential energy, it gains in kinetic energy, and vice versa. Now let's look at what happens to electric potential energy in different scenarios. A positive charge near another positive charge has high potential energy. A positive charge near a negative charge has low potential energy. A positive charge gains electric potential energy when it is moved in a direction opposite the electric field. A negative charge gains electric potential energy when it is moved in the same direction as the electric field. Those are the basics of electric potential energy, which has a strong resemblance to gravitational potential energy. Both depend on the position of an object in a field, and both can be positive or negative. To understand the equation for electric potential energy stored by a charge between two charged plates, let's look at the equation for gravitational potential energy and compare it to electric potential energy. The potential energy of an object due to gravity equals its mass times gravitational field strength times its height. So, the electrical equivalent of mass is charge, which is Q. Where G represents the strength of the gravitational field, we replace it with electric field, E. And the height above ground becomes the distance above the bottom plate. So we can write the equation for electric potential energy stored by a charge between two charged plates as the charge Q times the electric field E times the distance the charge has moved within the field, D. We've seen what electric potential energy is and that it is equal to the work a charge in a field can do. But how can we talk about it in a way that makes it useful to us? One way to describe it is per unit charge, which we call electric potential. Be careful not to confuse the two. I know the names are similar, but when we have a system with many charges, electric potential energy tells us the energy of all the charges we're working with. Electric potential tells us the energy of a single unit of charge. Electric potential, represented by a V, is the electric potential energy per unit charge. Let's talk about units, and that will make the difference between electric potential energy and electric potential easier to understand. Energy is measured in units of joules, right? A volt is defined as a joule per coulomb. When we calculate electric potential, we can simplify the units to volts. Electric potential is also called voltage. This term connects electric potential to the electricity we harness every day. Electric potential at a point in space depends on two main factors: the amount of charge creating the potential and the distance from that charge. We can write this out as another type of equation that looks like this. Electric potential V equals Coulomb's constant, K, times the charge responsible for the potential, Q, divided by the distance R from Q. What if we want to solve for electric potential at a point at which potential is created by more than one charge? The electric potential of multiple charges equals the sum of the potential of each individual charge at a point in space. Like electric potential energy, electric potential is a scalar quantity, so it's easy to add together. Now, how does that work? Say we have two charges, Q sub 1 and Q sub 2, and a point in space we'll call point A. Q sub 1 is 1 meter from point A, and Q sub 2 is 3 meters from point A. Q sub 1's charge is negative 5 times 10 to the negative 6 coulombs, and Q sub 2's is positive 5 times 10 to the negative 6 coulombs. We want to know what is the electric potential at point A. Recall that electric potential V equals K times Q divided by R. The potential at point A from Q sub 1 equals K times Q sub 1 divided by the distance between Q sub 1 and point A. K equals 9 times 10 to the 9th newton meters squared per coulomb squared. Q sub 1 equals negative 5 times 10 to the negative 6th coulombs. and r equals 1 meter. Plugging these numbers into the equation, we find that the potential at point A due to Q sub 1 equals negative 45,000 newton meters per coulomb, or volts. There's still one more thing that affects the potential at point A, and that's Q sub 2. The electric potential at point A equals the potential at point A due to Q sub 1 plus the potential at point A due to Q sub 2. So to solve for the total potential at point A, we'll need to know the potential at A from Q sub 2 as well. The potential at point A from Q sub 2 equals K times Q sub 2 divided by the distance between them. Q sub 2 is positive 5 times 10 to the negative 6 coulombs, and the distance r is 3 meters. Plugging these numbers into the equation, we see that the potential at point A from Q sub 2 equals 15,000 volts. That means the total potential at point A is negative 45,000 volts plus 15,000 volts, which equals negative 30,000 volts. That's the total electric potential at point A due to Q sub 1 and Q sub 2. Now I know we've covered a lot here, but these are key concepts for you to understand energy contained in electric charges and how we measure it. We went over two terms with similar names, electric potential energy, or energy stored by electric charges, and electric potential, which is the measure of electric potential energy per single unit of charge. We can use both to help harness the electric power that we use every day. That's it for this segment of Physics in Motion, and we'll see you next time.
For more practice problems, lab activities, and note-taking guides, check out the Physics in Motion Toolkit.